Adventure looks different to everyone. Amelia Earhart simply stated that adventure is worthwhile within itself. But you honestly can't really define adventure for yourself until you've wrestled with it. Without mistakes or conflict or breakdowns, your story will simply be boring. I believe that adventure is the distance between the present and your fulfillment of your dreams. How you navigate the in-between is the great unknown.
Different definitions of overlanding. I would call this more of a wheeling trail, you know? It's like people come up here just because it's a difficult trail.
What is it gonna look like, you think?
I'm not really sure, just seeing pictures. But I think we're gonna have lots of trees to cut down and lots of mud to winch through. It is a fairly difficult trail and it does have a high probability of breaking something. We've kind of saved this route for the end of our trip. So that if something does break, it's not messing up our whole trip.
In an effort to challenge ourselves, we evaluated several trails and road systems. Forest fires and other factors outside of our control directed our focus to the Alexander Mackenzie Heritage Trail in British Columbia.
This is kind of nice so far. A nice trail.
Yeah.
Hasn't been many people on it.
A historic trail in which the 4x4 portions have nearly become extinct. Frankly, we took this as a challenge to see how far we can go.
So here comes the trucks. I'm trying to stay ahead of them so I can get stuff like this out of the way. This is too short for us to get underneath. It'll probably catch us by one of the rooftop tents, so I'll try to get it dealt with before they get here, which they're coming right now. Hard to leave. Maybe this is how we'll do the whole trail, who knows?
There was very little information on this trail, and that honestly sparked our interest the most. We found a few online forums that had some details, but the details were often vague and dated. If we wanted to know what was down that trail, we just simply had to do it. The morning is spent preparing our gear for an all-out assault on the trail.
This morning we built these guards out of 550 cord. Typically these are made out of cable. We weren't planning on doing a trail this tight when we initially were preparing for this trip. So what these do is, as the branches come, they help keep them off your hood, off your windshield, so that you have less of a chance of scratches and breaking glass and bending things. So we will see how they work.
Started this trip at 150, and we're all getting smaller, and all of our pants are getting bigger. Feels kind of good though.
All right.
Oh. Hey, you Rambo.
Walkie-talkie, bear spray, gloves, face, machete.
No, stop.
Normally when stop. You come close to me, you get me.
And it stands true.
I'm in the military and I have a physical fitness test coming up for some training that we got to do. So I've been racking my head trying to figure out how to get in shape for this thing. And gotta run.
There's only one way.
You gotta run.
To run in front of the vehicles for 150 miles. Machete, yep. Everything out of the way.
Probably not 150 miles because I'm not that guy. But
right. Scott, this is the first time you haven't been wearing your lucky pants.
No, but I still got my Crocs on, so I still feel at home in that.
Tally-ho. And how can you go wrong when you got these two guys running ahead of you to clear the way?
We got, you can't. You could try to go wrong, but it wouldn't work.
It's like Lewis and Clark. Adventure is the respectful pursuit of trouble. That's today's adventure quote. So we respectfully are looking for trouble down this road.
The other thing about trouble is that it's never found where you anticipate it. It reveals itself generally in your weakness, and that's often where it hurts the most.
So we're only like a quarter mile down the road here, and this is why we're carrying the machete, because this would hold them up potentially or tear something off the top of the truck. So these are the quick ones
where we can.
What?
We cut myself.
Oh, here. Lock
it up.
Hey. It's not that bad.
Okay.
You need to calm down.
Yeah. No, it's just, that was like, where? How did that even happen?
It came out of my hand right here and bounced and went dunk.
Okay. Let me get a look at that.
It's all scar tissue.
Honestly, this accident can happen to anyone. Several of us have had a machete slip from our hands throughout the years.
I feel like a dummy.
Wearing pants might have prevented the injury, but we can't change that now. We all have to adjust to the situation.
It needs irrigation.
It's a big enough cut that I think it needs stitches for that. You're back home, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That's a good gash.
If we don't get this clean enough, infection will set in, and it's a big enough cut where it'll set in hard and fast, so.
Well, I'm quite embarrassed, to be honest with you, but...
He hit the tree.
Oh. Yeah, I whacked the tree, and it was just way more simple.
How many times are you going to do this?
A lot, bud. We got to get it out. We got to make sure it's clean.
Kind of a bummer. I was looking forward to running today. I think I'll still be able to run, maybe.
You won't be able to run.
Nah, you won't want to.
We had to be meticulous with our dressing.
Once we close it, we can't open it. Unless it gets infected.
We have set aside 4 days of travel with a couple contingency days to allow for any problems that might pin us down.
Just so we're all clear, if we're talking worst case scenario, we get in here 6 days from now and we get super stuck. And we're in here another 5 days before something happens. We can't count on a helicopter due to weather. So, given the remote location where we are, where we're headed, are we comfortable with being able to keep that clean with enough puncture or closure strips and water and hydration to know pretty confidently that you're not going to get infected back in here?
Are you asking me or everybody?
Everybody.
I think we need to do a little inventory on, because we're going to have to change that bandaging, the dressing. How much material do we have to do that?
That's a huge cut.
Yeah, it's not that it's deep or not, it's the surface area. A lot of space. I would hate for it to turn into an infection and then keep you from when you get back to your marine stuff.
That's the thing, marines.
Yeah, I mean, you just got.
So we did our final assessments, we shut some cameras off and did a little talking and went through our med kits and decided that we have enough of closure kits and suture stuff that we can change his dressing 2 more times, 3 more times in the next 5 days. So the one that he has on right now is the best. It's the most protected we'll ever get it. So we're gonna leave it on as long as possible unless we see sign of infection. And if we need to take it off, we will. But if we don't, maybe we'll get lucky. But anyway, we decided that we're gonna press on. And we also have enough medical gear that in the event of someone else getting injured, we can take care of them too. So we're 1.5 miles into this trail and it's taken us a day to get here. So we gotta make some ground.
Cell service is non-existent and weather will be an unknown other than our own basic knowledge on predicting mountain weather. We put Ty in the passenger seat for the day and later we'll move him into a driver's spot. That will provide the least amount of impact on the injury.
Woo!
Think we're gonna walk 150 miles?
Probably.
More chains on.
As soon as we thought the trail was heating up, it suddenly went cold.
Ryan.
Well, I found a really sweet hiking trail. So I'm wondering if the GPS tracks that I retrieved were the hiking trail GPS tracks. Because it seems like it's pretty close to the hiking trail. So yeah, looks like we gotta find a different way.
Well.
Yeah, look at the friggin' markers on it.
Crap.
Our eclectic information had led us into a wild goose chase.
There's a hiking trail and a 4x4 trail.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
So. We have any idea how well those parallel?
They run kind of the same area. The guy at the shop told me a different way than the tracks and everywhere else said.
Oh, so we go back so and go, we go back. The shop.
Yeah.
So.
Knowing what we now know, we reset our bearings.
So what we thought was the trail was actually a walking trail. And where we were at on the walking trail was actually not even the walking trail. It was just some random logging trail. So 65 miles away via back roads here, we have finally reached the mouth of the trail.
We hit the official start in the early evening. The scenery was magnificent, and our minds were filled with excitement over the 100 plus miles of trail before us. In the late 1700s, a fur trading outfit known as the Northwest Company made a push to find, preferably, a water route across the continent to the Pacific Ocean. Alexander Mackenzie, and an employee and shareholder of the Northwest Company, was commissioned to find this route.
Shallow gravel.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Sweet.
I earned it. I earned a dunce cap for today.
I'm the cheerleader today, and probably tomorrow, probably the next day.
It's so, okay, but it's time to get back to the rig.
It doesn't hurt if I gotta keep it straight.
Come
eh?
On, Olympic gear. Right. Come on.
Still following me, eh? Pour salt in the wound, eh?
In 1789, Mackenzie and 9 men made their way across the Rocky Mountains by canoe. Ultimately, however, he was advised by the Nazcotton people to turn north and access the Pacific Ocean over land. Guided by the Nazcotton people, Mackenzie made it to the Pacific and became the first known European to successfully cross the continent and return to tell about it. This great road has been in use for nearly 4,000 years, but with all the deadfall, it hasn't been traveled very much in recent years. Deadfall was becoming our worst nightmare.
I don't know if you can see it, but up there, there's just 2 branches holding this whole tree up.
It was apparent that we are going to have to be creative to complete this trail safely.
I wonder how many miles of this we're going to get. I mean, there's another tree immediately there. It's just as thick in the road. This is why it'll take us a while.
You can see we've got a tree at an angle across our trail. Those are affectionately called the Widowmaker. They're really dangerous to cut down. So what we're going to do is get our winch out. Our winch line is long enough. It exceeds the length of this tree, so we can effectively pull this and be outside of the fall range of this tree, and we won't have to take any risk of someone getting hurt by cutting it.
Nice, nicely done.
Well, we have this stuff here we can't forget either.
It's getting dark.
Yeah, we should find camp.
We're gonna leave stuff if we don't pay more attention too.
The other side though looks a little bit interesting. There's a really big dip there. It's all very wet, looks like mud.
What, any kind of word you have for us?
Yeah, it sinks pretty good there. Once you get into the middle of that, it's a little silty.
She's fat.
She's fat.
There's a real nasty channel right here.
Let me try it one more time. I put the front locker in.
Okay, it's half the time.
Oh, look at frogs. So. There's all kinds of frogs everywhere.
There are frogs everywhere.
Ah, it's an infestation.
Yeah, buddy. Go, 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 go. You're still moving. You're still moving. Ah. So cool.
I think I just stepped on a frog.
I think I probably stepped on a buffalo. Yeah.
It's moving.
We're moving.
Yeah.
Woo!
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Good job, Ryan.
Are you in the front locker?
Thank you, lockers. Up the way, it keeps getting worse.
Oh my gosh.
It is becoming clear that our daily mileages might be impossible to obtain.
There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 trees there, stuck to this one green tree here, and then they had one cut that's just hanging.
It's just holding on
by a couple branches, so. One goes, they all go, so we have to be way back here.
If these fall, they're gonna kick this one back up, right? And pop. So we gotta watch out for that too.
Yeah.
All right, clear.
Clear.
There it goes.
Yeah, see, it still wants to go.
Oh yeah, we probably can move it down.
Pull it.
You gotta watch yourself.
There we go. There it is.
I feel a little safer now. We still gotta get that one down.
Can we get a rope on it and pull it down?
Okay, you go for that. I'll clear the trail.
Driving through either pickup sticks, mousetrap, operation, and Jenga all mixed together.
Yeah.
You lose more than a bag of Skittles.
Yeah, they are.
I think Scotty's having a blast with that thing.
I think he is too.
Roger, so we just found out that we're roughly, this trail's gonna be about roughly between 100 and 110 miles. The next gas is about 136 to 146 away. And we are running right now at current rate. We have been on the trail for 2 hours and 45 minutes and we have gone approximately 3 miles.
Yep.
Roger that.
Sounds about right.
So, I think we should pull up here again tonight, powwow about that. I think our big push besides time is going to be fuel. I don't know if I'm going to have enough fuel.
Last night was intense in a good way and fun, but we're tired. So we're just now getting moving. My first order of the day is to check Ty's knee out to see how things are going. So pants.
That's the worst part of it, yanking your hair.
Yeah.
That could be cleaned up a little.
Yeah, we're gonna have to clean that. I gotta get a glove on.
It doesn't look that bad. I think it's just the iodine that made it look gross.
My only concern, Dar, is it's a fairly severe wound. Going in further when we're moving this slow.
This slow.
Is just, at this point, we have a fairly quick exit to just get out and get it taken care of.
Uh-huh.
But even if we go another day, coming back's gonna be 10 times faster.
It will be faster.
So even if we are in another 20 miles, it's gonna take us, you know, upwards of another, who knows, maybe another hour.
Ty's injury was definitely something we had to watch. Overall though, we feel confident that we can take care of it, even if it takes a turn for the worst.
Ready for another day. Hard trail. Pretty exhausted this morning, but we're excited to get going. I heard the chainsaws running right. Jeff and then took off and didn't make it very far before the chainsaws started firing up. So I think we're gonna have a long day of bushwhacking.
We had to hit our miles if we were to complete the trail in time.
Sounds good.
A couple four-wheelers came through our camp this morning just as we were getting ready to head out, and we were thinking, oh sweet, they're gonna be able to go break some trail. And they did. They went and broke some trail, but they broke it just wide enough for the four-wheelers. So
same amount of work for them.
Exactly, same amount of work for them, but a lot more work for us. Oh well.
We stayed in the four-wheeler's path for 6 miles, recutting everything they blocked already. In all honesty, it took a great deal of emotional effort to not let it get to us and maintain a positive morale. As we pushed deeper into the Mackenzie Trail, we found evidence of other travelers' misfortunes with her remoteness. Our small chainsaw that we threw in for good measure was becoming our lifeline to completing this trail. Had we known that it would be relied upon so heavily, we would have upgraded the saw to something more commercial.
We are putting a new chain on. I think the other chain that we had kind of had a little bent link in it. We got a couple more chains, extra chains, and we're popping a new one on now.
We're competing right now against three variables. One is time, one is fuel, and one is manpower. And honestly, there's a fourth, which is the chainsaw. If our chainsaw goes down, we gotta back out of here. There's like no other choice. History tells us that it's gonna probably be the same forward, and we can't do that with just an axe, a single axe.
So if any one of those things fail, we don't have enough time, we don't have enough fuel, we run out of the ability to physically do the work, or our chainsaw quits, we have to turn around. And none of us want to turn around. We want to complete this thing.
Oh, whoa. Look at that. That's a wolf track.
Rad.
Right next to that wolf track, just over there, is a grizzly track. It's pretty rad. And it looks like to be a front paw.
Looks to be like just an old Dodge. Abandoned, second Dodge. Abandoned here. That one's been there for a long time. This trail is no joke.
Despite our most careful efforts to preserve our vehicle's integrity and resources, failure was bound to happen.
Oh man.
Driving forward.
While watching my rear tire in the mirror, I failed to see a protruding log just below the hood line and proceeded to effortlessly skewer my truck while rolling it idle.
We're leaking something here.
Yeah,
yep.
Went right under.
Oh no.
Is that in our radiator?
Well. Yep. Yep.
Got jousted.
Either that or a battery.
Oh, that's a battery. No, wait, hold on.
Windshield washer fluid.
Windshield washer fluid?
Yep, skipped off the battery into the windshield wiper fluid, and then... Headlight's on.
We still got a headlight?
Yeah.
Not for long.
Not for long. No, not for long. So that's washer fluid. It missed everything else.
Wow.
Yep, that's a miracle right there.
That's the only time I've ever seen where liquid pouring out from under your hood isn't that bad.
Yeah.
I've never.
It was extreme luck that no mechanical damage happened. In fact, the headlight worked until its replacement a month later. It was apparent that the real damage was going to be in the little things over time. Not having a functioning rear shock in the Land Cruiser wasn't helping either. We decided to put the weight of the remaining fuel on the Kmar bumper into the tank of the Tacoma, in hopes of giving the slightest bit of relief to the struggling suspension.
Cruiser's climbing away the suspension. Oh, it's too bad we lost that shock. We put in another cheap shock that we could find that had about the same length, and sucker's bouncing pretty good. We left the other Icon in there because it has the best dampening ability, but it's going up and down, and hit our fuel tank a couple times pretty hard, the long range automotive tank, and it's just, we've probably lost a couple gallons and dents out of the capacity of that thing, but hey, we're getting it done. We're here. Corner, nose just drops right off, and then there's that.
Whoa. Yeah. You kidding me?
Ah. What do you think, Jeff?
I think this bridge will hold the Tacoma. I have no idea if it's going to hold the Land Cruiser.
Our combined weight of Land Cruiser and the X-Venture trailer is at 10,000 pounds. 5 tons. That should make anyone second guess this bridge located in the middle of nowhere. But we honestly don't have a choice.
Paul.
Whoa!
She's freaking balancing.
Wow!
Well, we made it.
Yeah, we made it. Okay.
Hey, let's go.
Soon, nowhere turned into somewhere. We just didn't know where that was. We rolled up at a remote fishing lodge.
Oh, it's got the trail marker.
Yeah.
The owners met us on the lawn, a little perplexed.
Well, are we in the right or the wrong place?
Even though it was late in the evening, they graciously invited us in and showed us our current location and overall situation.
And then sitting down here,
these are burned down.
Oh, that one burned down?
Oh, bummer.
They all burned down.
Is that where the fire,
big fire,
where was the fire came through? Like 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. That was like 2 years ago?
2010.
Okay. When is the last recorded information that we're pulling from the internet here?
Most of it's... I don't know, I'll have to see what the, I think what most the of it's, Land Cruiser Club was, but the one that I'm looking at right now is from like 6 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I remember
the
Land Cruiser crew.
About 6 years ago.
About 6 years ago.
That's about how much wood you're going to have over the trail.
Yeah.
Sure.
You guys need some firewood?
At this point in time, there's... I mean, we don't have the time to do that.
Yeah.
We don't have the resources or the fuel or the man hours.
Or
the chainsaw.
The
poor chainsaw.
Take care.
Have a good season.
Yeah, thank you.
With some solid info, we backtracked a little ways and nervously crossed back over the decayed bridge and parked by the next morning's river crossing.
Okay, there you go.
Yeah, go ahead and pull forward a little bit.
We efficiently set up camp. Ty and I did a quick check on his gash again, and then set off to other evening chores.
This keeps me from getting greasy and dirty. My nice clothes, ex officio clothes, keeps them nice and pressed, and oil on them. It's very good. It's very, very good. And the boys bought this for me, and they think it was a joke on me, but the joke's on them because I like it.
Oh, there's the ragu.
Dinner that evening was spaghetti, and it was fantastic. The next morning, Ty and I took one last hard look before pushing further into the trail.
I think we're just going to close it up a little bit further for now and take one more day and evaluate again tomorrow morning.
Day by day.
Mm-hmm.
Just have a little bit of time left in our trip now. And the decision on what to do next is not coming easy. Late last night, we came up to that camp, to that lodge, and they said that, you know, basically you can't get through here. It hasn't been cut in a long time. He had a recollection of the last Land Cruiser that he saw was like 6 years ago. So, but after yesterday, today's day seems daunting. We'll see how this goes. I think we got 15 miles to make today. Yesterday it took us, what, 8 hours to go 10?
Across the river, the trail all but disappeared. Jeff stepped out of the truck to see where it went. Not long into the day, the chainsaw was again fueled and oiled. The trail work was exhausting and brutal. We didn't really talk much. The work was all-consuming, forming an unspoken effort to make miles.
Tell you that there's a lot of trees that fall down in here, and we're just getting maybe a little weather or maybe a front change
And usually on the end, the front of a front is a wind. And we're just watching these trees just start to whip and crack. With one solid gust, this thing could be a big problem. So we're gonna pick up the pace even harder and just keep moving to get out of this. Because this is dangerous.
There was a feeling of absolute adventure not knowing what was ahead. People and machines working together to accomplish a goal.
He's in it now.
We removed countless logs, throwing tons of collective weight throughout the day. Suddenly, out of nowhere, a break in the trail. A recent clear-cut operation had totally wiped out the trail and turned the route into a minefield of sticks and stumps. A tire puncture seemed inevitable.
Checking all our tires, that was brutal.
I've never been through anything like that.
No tire should be able to go, should have to go through that.
Yeah.
We're at like 7,000 miles-ish into our trip and still haven't had a flat. And then we just rolled through all of that. And when my fingers crossed.
We have one flat.
We have a flat?
This one's got a slow leak.
Oh, well, I'm not surprised.
No.
Better off putting another hole in a bed in the tire that's got a hole in it versus putting a spare on. We'll just watch it.
The leak was very slow, so we decided to keep rolling on this tire in case of another puncture. The road out also proved to be slow. Our limping cruiser required special attention as we worked the road's cutouts. Then a cutout of cutouts was before us. Obviously, the logging outfit didn't want people coming into this area. They apparently didn't anticipate anyone coming in from the trail like we did. Our max tracks became our saving grace, effectively reducing the amount of aggressive wear and tear on our precious asset. Reaching a road, a victory dance resembling something out of Charlie Brown humored us. Up the road, we eased into our evening's goal, the quiet Indian village we had been told about.
So we have found and hit the village, and we're slowly rolling in town.
Well, this is the village.
Right there, there's a church over there.
Yeah.
We crashed hard that night and slept like never before. In the morning, we woke to horses coming down for their morning water and the sound of men working.
We rolled into camp and there's some folks out on the porch, and so we didn't film, respectfully, just driving into camp. We just rolled into the town, quiet, and stepped out and talked to those people. And they were like, yeah, camp where you want. Recommend down there by the lake. It's real nice. And so that's what we did. With their favor, we camped right here. And now we're going to go back up there and talk to one of the elders of the village here.
In this community.
He was a kind man who once made his living as a hunting guide.
Are you one of the leaders then?
We wanted to have his blessing to continue to go through their land.
This group of rocks is from Idaho.
Huh?
It's from Idaho.
Yeah.
And this is just our way of saying thank you and for letting us be here and to pass through your place.
Graciously returned a gift, an arrowhead he had found down below in the field in which we were camped.
I guess it was a good one. I found part of it in there.
Wow.
And it's ammonia, just like it lasts, you know.
Wow.
The exchange was awesome. And we carry this arrowhead in the truck to this day. Through talking to him, we also found out that a great battle happened on the field we are camped on, known as the Last Battle of Tuscus. It was so brutal that a river of blood flowed into this lake, all over the love of a woman. We then obtained our last bit of local knowledge on how to proceed. Being some 50 miles into the trail, we had to make sure nothing else went wrong. We simply can't afford a mistake without serious consequences.
Just when you get to the dirt road, just keep going this way. Don't turn off nowhere.
Okay.
Unless you know where you're going.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've exhausted a couple of our resources. Manpower is low, but we still got it. But we're running out of fuel. And our chainsaw, we can't be that dependent on the single chainsaw if we're gonna have to cut that much. Eugene said the trees are like this all the way through for miles, and it hasn't been cut. And the other thing is time. Basically, right at the end of our trip, and we don't have the ability to push that much harder into something that's pretty much guaranteed to be that extreme. On another note, Ty's leg. Even though it's healing well and we're comfortable with it, if something else were to happen at this point in time, we don't have the bandages and the medical aid to give that person, especially if we were to get stuck out there for a couple days. So at this point, our risk assessment says that we have to finish out this last little bit of the trail. We're going to take a right, apparently, up here, and bail out to a Forest Service road, which is still 100 and some odd miles, 150 miles to Quesnel back.
Masu crossing, and that means that basically if we take this trail, we got another 2 or 3 miles, and then we hit supposedly a Forest Service road that's in better condition. Most likely it is. So gentlemen, I think we've reached the end of the Mackenzie Trail as we can do it. Here we go.
In mountaineering, there is an old saying that says, climbing down the mountain is still climbing the mountain.
All right, you're on. There you go.
That philosophy applies here. Even though you're headed off the trail, you're not out of the woods yet. Fighting the urge to rush, it took everything in us to maintain our focus toward getting out of here in one piece. But fatigue is inevitable, and focus will drop, making even a small thing into a big thing.
You want on top? You want on top or bottom? It's inside.
Attempting to slip between two downed trees, the Land Cruiser's wheel width gets the best of us.
That's how deep.
Here it is.
Too wide.
Blown?
It's ripped off.
It's ripped off.
Extra shock.
Extra shock is ripped off.
The team made quick work of the tire. We also found that our improvised shock had been ripped from the mount and destroyed, and was doing us no good. We now no longer have any extra tires, and the front tire still has a slow leak.
Must have overextended it.
Nope, you should be good. Because I have a jack stand under it, so.
The night closed in.
It ends up unblocked.
We had little GPS signal, and the trail continued to be hard to follow. It was apparent that it had been years since someone had traveled this portion of the trail. The trail was grown in so severely, we had to chop our way through. Scotty fired up the chainsaw one last time and exhausted the last bit of fuel that we had to spare.
Whew.
At this point, we're using everything we have. We have no spare tires. Our power cable for the trailer is destroyed. The Land Cruiser auxiliary battery is dead. Our drinking water, gone. Fuel calculations estimate our range at 130 miles. Just enough to get out if everything goes right. The Tacoma's headlight is smashed. There is no longer shocks on the Land Cruiser's rear axle. Medical supplies are diminished, and we are currently shooting on the red minutes of camera space. The guys are exhausted. Things are getting pretty gnarly. As far as we know, the main road is somewhere on the other side. Not knowing for sure, there was a sense of uneasiness. In a pitch black night, we are very thankful for the extraordinary light being thrown from our rigid light bars.
Okay, so that doesn't really look like the road over there anymore.
It kind of looks like it over here, maybe. Yeah, like right. Oh.
Maybe, to the right.
To the right?
A little bit.
Dude, it's getting deep fast.
Okay, stop here.
We lost the left-hand, being able to see the left-hand side when we drove out there, and we're just not seeing an obvious trail.
Roger. Where's the GPS say?
That's kind of straight in line with the path that we've been following. I mean, this might be a little bit deeper than we're expecting, too.
Roger.
I might be. What do you think? Does it maybe go straight up river?
Let me climb out on the bar.
Okay. I got a pretty heavy draft that comes through the center right there. You can see the ripples.
Where are we?
This is crazy.
Oh man, holy cow!
This is a hole.
Our 10,000 mile journey was coming down to a single bit of trail. Finding the way out is a dire priority.
Okay, keep going. It gets shallower. There's a road.
Found it?
I think so.
Straight up the bank?
Is that?
We found it. The road's over here.
Pretty good wake going.
Yeah.
Come up that way. The road. I am pointed directly towards the road as you see.
Roger that.
Here we go. We're on the road.
Whew.
Dude, we made it.
We made it.
Reaching the other side brought on one of the most exhilarating moments of relief. And then, almost simultaneously, a personal realization that we had just reached the end of our adventure. Running on fumes, our thoughts wandered in memories as we pointed home. Just a couple years ago, we were a few buddies that had a simple dream: to travel the world by self-reliant vehicle. For all of us on this journey, the decision to embark upon it has been a catalyst to change. We found that overlanding has this way of letting you escape the world by stepping into it. It makes you confront fears and empowers discovery. And don't be surprised if that discovery is mostly within.
I will never be the same. I will never see life the same way. I'll never go through life just being okay or settling for the normal. Because normal is what you make it.